of such equations. Now we have n capital unknown functions and some set of constants. C, I, J, K are constants. And the question is, for which constants this model is integrable? This is a statement. This model is integrable if and only if C, I, J, K are structure constants of a Jordan algebra. For me, this is remarkable because we have no any hints for Jordan algebras in integrability, and the result can be formulated in terms of pure algebraic structure. So, of course, I should discuss first what is integrable and probably what is a Jordan algebra also. But let me demonstrate an example first. Suppose we have a finite dimensional algebra with a basis, and let's consider the following. This is a definition of a structure constants, and let's consider the following element of our algebra where u, k are just unknown functions from the model. If we introduce this object, we can rewrite our system in a very short form, algebraic form, where this is a multiplication in unknown algebra A. And it's a good question. Yes, I agree. And we can discuss this. I will go back to the examples later. But now so now in the pure algebraic description of our system, we can ask for which multiplications this model is integrable. And the answer, again, if and only if this is a Jordan multiplication. I am cheating a little bit, you're right. But if I additionally assume that multiplication is commutative, then this is an exact statement. If not, there is some additional information I don't want to discuss now, a bit later. But instead, let me consider the most important example. The definition of the Jordan algebras are a little bit complicated. I mean the identities, but this is the most important example. If we have an associative algebra, and if we consider the anti-commutator operation, then this product is Jordan multiplication. And what we have here in this case, here we have just this model where U now is a matrix of arbitrary size, and here we have U UX plus UX U. So this is so-called matrix Korteweg de Vries equation. It's known to be integrable. What else in the introduction? Okay, now about integrability. I want to describe an approach to integrability developed by you see, this is not a complete list of participants, and it was maybe not, I would say, till now. And this is the definition. differential equation, partial differential equation is integrable if it has infinitely many generalized infinitesimal symmetries. Now, what is generalized infinitesimal symmetries? And the second question, why? If equation has, why integrable equation should have infinitesimal symmetries? It's there. First of all, what the infinitesimal symmetries means for ordinary differential equation. Suppose we have a dynamical system. This is a dynamical system. And the infinitesimal symmetry is another dynamical system with a different time, t and tau here, such that they are compatible. Compatibility means, informally speaking, if we take initial data in our phase space, we can move by the time t using the first dynamical system, take this for the initial data, shift by tau using the second system, and we can do the same, but in the opposite. First, we use the second, and after that, the first. In general, we will get the different points, but if these systems are symmetries for each other, we will get the same point here. This is informal definition, and the formal definition is we can associate the vector field x with this system as usual, and the vector fields y with this system, and compatibility means that these vector fields commute each other. This is a definition of infinitesimal symmetry for ordinary differential equations. About partial differential equations. Today I will consider equations of this form or systems of such equations. Let's fix the notation. I will use the notation un with low indices. Un is just partial derivative of u with respect to x. So it's the usual notation in differential algebra. And if I have such evolutionary differential equation, the symmetry is another equation of this form with different time, such that they are compatible. Of course, I can reformulate the compatibility as the commutativity of the corresponding vector fields, but for me, I would say this is a definition, but what I mean here. I can differentiate this with respect to t, and I will have here, if I differentiate this with respect to t, I will have here t derivative, and I can eliminate them using the first equation. So I will get some expression depending only on x derivative. And I can differentiate this with respect to tau and kill tau derivative uses using this. And the result should be identity with respect to all these variables. So this is the definition, and this is the way how it works. And now some examples of integrable equations, integrable in this sense, equations which have infinitely many symmetries. First of all, let's start from the linear equation. Any linear equation, like heat equation, it has infinitely many symmetries, namely for any m, this is the symmetry for these equations. The compatibility is a very simple computation. Now about nonlinear equations. First of all, Let's consider the so-called Burger's equation. It looks like Korteweg-de-Vries equation, but with a second derivative here. It turns out that it has infinitely many generalized symmetries. This is the simplest generalized symmetry. It has a third order. This equation has also fourth, fifth, and so on order symmetries. This is a Kadewi equation. The simplest symmetry has order 5. The next has order 7, and so on. And today I will try to generalize this equation. We already discussed the result, and maybe something more. Now I want to explain, this is not rigorous explanation, but some explanation why integrable equation should have infinitesimal symmetries. I would say that integrable for nonlinear equations means that you can reduce the equation to a linear equation somehow by some transformation. So this is integrability. Not you can integrate your equation in quadrature, but you can reduce it to a linear equation somehow. But if it's true, if we have a transformation to reduce our nonlinear to a linear, or the inverse transformation from linear to nonlinear, for example, here, let's consider the Burgess equation and the heat equation. It turns out that for any solution of heat equation, you satisfy the Burgers equation. It's so-called Kolhoff transformation. But we can, and we know that the linear equation has infinitely many symmetries. What if we will apply the same transformation to symmetries? We will get symmetries for nonlinear equations. So it works. It works also for Korteweg-de-Vries equation. In the case of KdV, the transformation is not so simple. The transformation is some generalization of Fourier transform, nonlinear Fourier transform, quite complicated, but there is a transformation. But we cannot use this observation as a definition of integrability because we cannot describe the class of transformations. Such transformations, okay, but non-local. But we can use the existence of infinitesimal symmetries as a, if you want, as a definition of integrability or as an indication of integrability. For me, it's a definition today. You are right again. In the case of systems, I should be a bit. But now I want to demonstrate how this definition works, how it one can use it for classification of integrable systems. Let's consider the following simple classification problem. Let's consider the following equations of fifth order with unknown constants A1, A2, A3, and we want to find all integrable models of this kind. Let's try to find all such models that has symmetry of this form. This is not assumption, actually. This is a homogeneous differential polynomial And this is a homogeneous differential polynomial of seventh order. All possible terms are here. So how it works? We find the compatibility. We differentiate this with respect to tau, differentiate this with respect to t, eliminate t and tau derivative, and we get some big polynomial depending on what? Depending on u, u1, etc., u10. After differentiation, arise some higher derivatives. And now we, and this polynomial should be identically zero. And we look at the different homogeneous components of this polynomial. First of all, we find, consider the quadratic terms, we find the explicit formulas for C1, C2, and C3. For these three coefficients. Quadratic, give me quadratic. After that, cubic terms give me all expressions for other coefficients. Oops, sorry. For these coefficients and first relation between the coefficients of the equation we consider. It turns out that A3 is given by this formula. For fourth degree terms, we will get the expression, some expression for the last coefficients and symmetry, and they find the crucial nonlinear relation of this kind. We see that we have three different integrable models. This is just symmetry of KdV equation, and this is two more so-called Kupi-Schmidt equation and Savada-Cotter equations. And it turns out that all other coefficients disappear and all these equations really has the symmetry of seventh order. But a lot of questions about this computation arises. First, why we assume that the order of the symmetry is 7. Why not 27, for example? We want to get some conditions for the right-hand side of our equation, which does not depend on the order of symmetry. This is the first. Second, using our approach, we found one by one the coefficients of symmetry, but we don't need them. We don't want to find the symmetry. We want to find the conditions like this for our equations. Is it possible to eliminate symmetry and formulate some conditions only for the right-hand side of the equation? The second question. And we use this approach for polynomial systems with polynomial right-hand side. What about say rational right-hand sides and so on. It turns out that it's possible to develop a technique which solves all these problems. And I want to say several words about this. To formulate the approach, I need the non-commutative Lorentz series like this. We have infinitely many terms here. The coefficients are function on u, u1, u2, and so on. D is the total derivative, total x derivative. And what? It's known that the set of all such non-commutative series form a skew field if we define the product by the usual way. It's usual for differential operators, but we also can extend this formula for the negative k. This is a way to define the product of two series. It's known it was introduced at least by Gelfand and Dickey, but probably before. It should be something classical. A is, now it's just, I consider the one field systems. In the case of systems, they will be matrices, but now they are scalar function depending on our x derivatives. Now the definition. We call the following pseudo-differential series formal symmetry if this object satisfy the following operator identities. What is important that F stars here is defined just by the right-hand side of our equation. So for given equation, we know this. And we want to find L, all coefficients of L. Step by step, we consider coefficients of the highest powers of D here, find these coefficients, after that this, and what? It turns out that we have obstacles. On each step, we will find the following expression. D applying to the next coefficients, LK, is something known depending on U, etc. So every time we should invert the total derivative. And it gives me an obstacles for this procedure. Why? What we can say about this if I want to solve this equation? S is not arbitrary. For example, if you look at the formula for total derivative, let's apply D to a function. D applying to F of U M is just DF DUM UM plus 1. And this is the only place where we have the highest derivative. So we see that this is linear in the highest derivative. So if this is nonlinear in highest derivative, we have no solutions. But of course, this is not obstacles. It's known that the if and only if conditions for S is that earlier operator applying to S should be identically zero. So we will have some obstacles, 1, 2, 3, and these obstacles give me partial differential equations for the right-hand side of our systems, for F. And in this approach, it does not matter is it F polynomial or rational, simply local analytic. So now what is the relation between symmetries and formal symmetry? It turns out that if our equation has infinitely many symmetries, then it has the formal symmetry. And in this statement, the order of symmetries are not important. The statement does not depend on concrete orders of symmetries. Only infinitely many symmetries then. And it turns out that if we have infinitely many local conservation laws, then again, we have a formal symmetry. And this is different statements if the equation is not Hamiltonian, like Berge's equation. So we see that the existence of a formal symmetry is a necessary condition for integrability. And now we can look at the first classification result. This is a complete classification of all equations of the Kertész-Weck de Vries form. F of u, u1, and u2 are unknown functions. And it turns out that we have only five different integrable models of this kind up to some transformations. We see, I don't want to describe the transformations here, but some simple transformations, not like inverse scattering method transform. We see the Kertész-Weck de Vries equation, so-called modified Kertész-Weck de Vries equation, and three more integrable models, rational. This is not rational, but we can rewrite this in rational form. And these two models look like elliptic, because we have arbitrary polynomial of fourth degree here. And if we make a Möbius transformation, they transform as a usual way. But it's a non-trivial question. It turns out that this is really elliptic model for generic Q, and this is not. But I don't want to discuss this. Now, what does it mean to say that model is elliptic or not? But you see that this approach works without any restrictions for right-hand side, without any restrictions on the orders of symmetries. There are a lot of results of classification results. But now I want to discuss the situation with multi-component systems. This?
Yes. So you say
this is a definition of formal symmetry. This is just a formal series that satisfies to this identity, where F star is the Fréchet derivative of the right-hand side. And I claim that this definition gives me some obstacles for coefficients of L, first of L, but these obstacles give me some information about F. They give me some partial differential equations for F totally.
Is there any reason to have F star of this particular form?
First, the reason is these theorems. But actually, the different name of this guys is the formal recursion operator. If you remember the Leonard scheme, and of course you remember, we have a recursion operator which generates all symmetries for KdV. And any recursion operator satisfies exactly this identity. But this recursion operator for KdV is not formal series, but some rational non-commutative function. This is a ratio of two differential operators. But in this approach, we consider only L. L is recursion operator. If we, in the KdV case, the recursion operator L is d square plus, I don't remember the coefficients, like this. This is real recursion operator. This is the quotient of two Hamiltonian operators. And this quotient satisfies this identity. But when we prove such statements, we don't think that this is recursion operator. For KdV, the square root from this. It's true. Okay, now, first remark is we can generalize all these concepts like formal symmetry to the case of matrix equations. Let's consider the evolutional equations with unknown, not scalar function, but matrix of arbitrary size n by n matrix depending on x and t. This is an example of integrable matrix model, and there is a classification of integrable matrix polynomial models, and there is a generalization of the definition of these guys, and for the matrix models, the coefficients are not matrices, but they are operators defined in terms of left and right multiplications by some matrices U, Ux, and so on. And we can generalize this recursion operator for KdV. We will have some additional non-local terms here, but still it's a ratio of differential operators. And first of all, it works for the evolutional equations with matrix unknown functions. And now about more general situation, I will come back to my statement. So it turns out that this system has infinitely many symmetries, if and only if, again, I'm cheating, several more. If we consider this system, we can apply any linear transformation, and we will get a different system with different constants, but of the same form. It could happen that after a linear transformation, we can derive some independent subsystem of the same form. In this case, we will say that the system is reducible. And the system is irreducible if we cannot derive a subsystem by a linear transformation. It's easy to prove that irreducibility is equivalent to the fact that the corresponding algebra is simple. Not only for Jordan case, this is a general statement. So we see that, as usual, the simple algebras are the most important in the picture. They are some bricks, elementary. And about irreducible systems, this is already correct statement. If the system is irreducible, and if it has infinitely many symmetries, then Cijk is a structure constant of Jordan algebras. Now we have additional point. We don't assume that they are commutative. This is the result. If it's integrable and irreducible, then Cijk are symmetric with respect to J and K, and they are just Jordan multiplication. So this is a formal definition of Jordan algebra. First, they are commutative, and the following fourth degree identity should be satisfied. Some kind of associativity, but special associativity with x square here. But for us, the examples are important. We already mentioned about this matrix example, but there is, another simple Jordan algebra with the following multiplication. If we have a n-dimensional vector space with a scalar product, then and we fixed a constant, so-called fixed element here, then this product satisfies the Jordan identities. So scalar product x with C is a constant multiplied by vector, this is a vector, and so on. But there are some more interesting examples. For example, the Jordan, special Jordan algebra of dimension 27. Let me say several words about these Jordan examples. In our construction with Dreyfus, we consider only principal nilpotents. Recently, Victor Katz with collaborators generalized this construction, construction of integrable classical models to the case of arbitrary nilpotent. And these Jordan examples, it turns out, corresponds to so-called short nilpotents. And the short nilpotents give me the complete set of simple Jordan algebras and therefore the complete set of irreducible integrable systems of this kind. Okay, now, and you can see here the integrable KdV equation related to this Jordan algebra. It was new at before our paper with Sergei Svinolupov. What will happen if we consider not KdV but Burger's equations? In this case, we will get a different sort of algebras, not Jordan, but so-called left symmetric algebras. So Burger's corresponds to left symmetric. KdV corresponds to Jordan. Now it's about left symmetric examples of Burger's equations. And now let's consider the generalized modified KdV equation. If you remember, for modified KdV equation, we have cubic right-hand side. And what we should do here, again, we consider the system with unknown constants. Again, we ask for which constants this is integrable. Now we consider them as a structure constant, not of algebra, but of a triple system. And it turns out that this is integrable if and only if. Here, I think it's correct statement, if and only if. This is so-called triple Jordan system. Again, the relations between integrability and Jordan non-associative algebras. I don't want to give, this is a formal definition of triple Jordan system, but this is a main example again, matrix example, or associative example. If we have associative algebra, and we consider the following operation, triple operation, this is a simple triple Jordan system. Okay, but now I want to discuss, and this is a matrix modified KdV equation related to just this matrix triple Jordan system. Now I want to discuss, let's discuss this very briefly. In my paper with Peter Olver, the following integrable matrix models with two unknown matrices, U and V, was found. And now we can ask, we can generalize to set here unknown triple systems, here and here, and we want to find which triple systems arised here. So it more or less new results and more or less new algebraic identities. It turns out that this triple system should satisfy the following three identity. Of course, in the associative case, if we consider the triple system is just a product of three elements, certainly it's whole, but I don't know. Maybe we can find some interesting examples of simple triple systems with these identities. Maybe not, but. Mm-hmm?
Can you explain the second formula? So, looking, this one. So, looking at the first, this guy, it should be symmetric in the first two arguments, right?
This?
Yes.
No, it's the matrices.
Oh.
It's the matrix. The first step was we classified with Peter Olver and without him some integrable models where U or U and V are matrices. And it one of the new integrable models we found with Peter. And now we want to generalize this to the case of unknown triple systems, and we get this if and only if statement. This is integrable if and only if these three. I want to stress that the last identity means that if we fixed y for any y, the product b x, y, z for fixed y is associative. Y is not only one element. This is a vector space of these y's. So we have a family of associative products such that the linear combination of them is associative product as well. It's close to bi-Hamiltonian formulations, and there are some examples and results about this, but I have no time to discuss it. So we see that we can find some new, formerly new algebraic structures, and this is a question to pure algebraists, the classification of all simple triple systems satisfying to these identities. But what about the rational models? How we can generalize the rational models? For example, this. The main question is, what is u to the power minus 1? What is this for algebras? It turns out that we can give the following nice definition. In the scalar case, we can say that 1 over x is a homogeneous solution of this ODE. It turns out that we can consider some systems of ODEs such that the solution, homogeneous solution, is just inverse, say, for triple Jordan systems. And it will give us the correct inverse elements in the, say, in the matrix situation, or we can define the inverse for vector product. So there is a way to define the inverse element. There are some, of course, definition pure algebraic, known to algebraists, but I prefer this. There are several reasons. And using this way, we can generalize the models with rational dependence of some derivatives. But I want to say several words. Now I am trying to work with this. The relation between integrable models with geometry, not with algebra. Let's consider the following systems. We see that they are polynomial with respect to derivatives, but we have some sets of unknown functions depending on U only. And again, the question is for which coefficients, now they are not constant but functions, we have integrable models. And in this case, the description should be done in the geometrical terms. Why? Because if we apply a general transformation of U, we immediately see that these functions transform just as the components of an affine connection. So here we have an affine connection. About B, it would be nice to have a tensor here, but we should do some renormalization. If we rewrite our system in this form, this is a we introduced beta instead of B. It turns out that in this form, beta is just tensor. So our models are described by connection and a tensor. And the question is for which connections and for which tensors they are integrable. In the scalar case, n equal to 1, we have the following system, and you can find very quickly using the symmetry approach I described before. This is the only conditions of integrability. But we still have transformations of U, and in the case of n equal to 1, any connection is flat, so we can kill this term. And from here we have beta equal to 1, so up to transformations we have UT equals to UXX plus constant UX cube. Its equation is known to be integrable. But for the systems, connections are not flat, and we have a real geometry here. And let me formulate something. I will use the notation R is the curvature tensor, and T is the torsion. And let's look to the following necessary integrability conditions. I claim that if our system is integrable, then the following two geometrical conditions should be satisfied. First is covariant derivative of the curvature can be expressed in terms of curvature and the torsion. In particular, if we consider the connection without torsion, we get from here symmetric spaces. So the first condition means that this is symmetric spaces. And second condition is here, what is delta? Delta is the following nice tensor. If we have no curvature, this is just, if we have no torsion, we have just curvature. But in the general case, this tensor, this is some mixed tensor. We see here torsion and curvature. And this means that this tensor is covariantly constant. So we come to the generalization of symmetric spaces. Just this tensor should be covariantly constant. I tried to find some geometrical works about this, but I have a feeling, maybe it's maybe somebody knows, but I still have no any information about such generalization of symmetric spaces to the case of non-zero torsion. And also we have some, and what is sigma? Sigma is more or less this tensor beta. So instead of beta, I consider connection and sigma. And we see that sigma is covariantly constant, so we have some covariantly constant deformation of something. And in particular case, when the torsion is zero, we see the following description of integrable cases. Except, so if torsion is zero, then we have first symmetric space, and also we have a tensor which satisfies to the following three assumption. First, this tensor is covariantly constant, and second, for any given U, they defined the triple Jordan system. So in other words, we have a special deformation, covariantly constant deformation of a triple Jordan system. So in the algebraic situation, we have triple Jordan systems, and in this geometric situation, we have some special deformations of triple Jordan systems. The structure constant depends on U. But unfortunately, I have no the geometric systems. To get such deformation, we need what? We need some quadratic nonlinearity with a tensor here. But in this case, the quadratic nonlinearity corresponds to affine connection, but to tensor. But it's possible to construct some class of examples where we actually have deformations of Jordan algebras. And this is the last formula I want to show. But this is not invariant. Alpha is the deformation of Jordan algebra, but this is not a tensor. So it's a special, in a special coordinate system, so we actually have a deformation of Jordan structure constants of Jordan algebras. But this is not all. This is only class of integrable models with zero torsion. And the general situation when the torsion is not zero, in this case, even I have no the complete set of integrability conditions. And the geometry for me is unclear, so it's an open problem I am going to work just now to understand what is the geometry is under these integrable models. Also, we can consider, maybe it's more interesting for physicists, we can consider the following systems, hyperbolic systems. Uj x u k y, the so-called sigma models. And in this case, this is a affine connection. If you make the transformation, it's just a fine connection. And the question is to find all integrable models of this kind. But the problem is the symmetry approach worked perfectly for evolutionary equation. But if we have hyperbolic systems, we have some difficulties there. But this is very good open problem. There are some class of examples of such integrable models, but the complete classification is not done. Well, that's all. Yeah.
Iterability
yes.
For KDB,
and for burgers.
Triple Jordan.
Yeah. Yeah, in the case of nonlinear Schrödinger written in the form of system with two, we have again triple Jordan systems, or more general, Jordan pairs. Jordan pairs is a known structure appears here, and the result was obtained by Sergei Svinalupov in Communication and Mathematical Physics. It was published. For Businesk. So I don't know about Businesk system, and actually I'm going to try the ansatz for Businesk in future. So actually the field of for research, and the problem was Sergei Svinalupov started it. It was my former PhD student, and he started this activity, but he died unexpectedly in the age of 36, and after that this activity stopped for 20 years more or less, and now I'm trying to start it again. This geometric story and systems like Businesk and other possible integrable models. Well, we see that generalization looks interesting and reasonable. Yeah. Yeah, there is a generalization of Miura transformation, and yes, and there is a well-known formula how to obtain the triple Jordan systems starting from Jordan algebra, and this formula give me a relation, but not give me relation, but these models, modified KdV and KdV. Is related by the Miura transformation. But not all modified KdV equations can be obtained by this Miura transformation.
Second question is that the word Hamiltonian was missing from the talk. How is this system known to be Hamiltonian?
Some of them, I believe that all of them are Hamiltonian, but you know, even in the KdV case, the Hamiltonian operator is not local. It's rational. For the KdV case, this Hamiltonian operator is local. But for the matrix KdV equation, we have still two Hamiltonian structure. One is still dx. But the second Hamiltonian structure, it was a differential operator of third order, but now it's not differential operator, it becomes non-local, some additional terms appear. And it's difficult to work with non-local objects. We don't know some ansatz for this. If we require the locality, we will have no Hamiltonian operators at all here. But and even the first one.
And the third question is that we defined your L, which was a Lyapunov operator, by embedding your system into the set of pseudo differential operators. Such
yeah.
Such an embedding, does it exist for other examples?
You mean real recursion operators or formal?
Just have a bending with coordinates which are used. U1, U2, U3.
Yeah.
So you have three functions as a coordinates, but you started with embedding your system into the set of sub-differential operators. So every U, you associate certain sub-differential operator.
Yes.
And is it possible to do, are such embeddings relevant to other answers you get?
So this is our formal series. The coefficients depend on previous last. Okay.
So this A capital is just embedding from your phase space of your differential equation into pseudo differential symbols.
Yeah.
For other examples, those are such maps. Such maps.
What do you mean by other examples? For all examples, we have a theorem that for all integrable models, we have such formal repression operator. So this is the main statements. If it has infinitely many symmetries, this means integrable, then we have this formal recursion operator with the local coefficients. Thank you.
Это
сейчас связано примерно так. Вы берете